In a time before Marvel, in a time before Star Wars, in a time before live-action remakes, Disney was struggling to find a plan for its future productions. It was the new millennium, and Disney was on its third chairman in 3 years, and its box office totals had fallen all the way to fifth place among the studios. Family films had found their way over to Warner Brothers, as Lord of the Rings and Harry Potter captured the public's imagination. And the hits from Disney were coming from Pixar, which accounted for half of Disney's operating income from 1999 to 2001. Disney desperately needed an infusion of fresh ideas and hits fast. Michael Eisner was becoming increasingly involved in studio operations to make this happen. The Wall Street Journal noted his uneasy insertion into the movie-making process. In the article, Michael Eisner is taken to task for being hopelessly out of touch, a man desperately trying to keep up with the times, instead of relying on younger, hipper, and more qualified executives. The story wondered aloud why a CEO of a conglomerate would bother reading the script for The Hot Chick. He questions why characters smoke and use profanity, and why jokes have to be so dirty. The Hot Chick meeting is particularly telling, as Eisner asks a female executive, "Will women find it offensive to be called chicks?" To which she replies, "Not if you call them hot." Eisner's competence as a leader was continually being questioned as Disney's stock was dropping. So Michael Eisner and the studio set two plans in motion. One was to create low-budget features for the whole family, in part based on the success of The Princess Diaries. The second part of the plan was a reversal of the usual Disney synergy. Instead of basing Disneyland rides on movies, why not base movies on Disneyland rides? And so Walt Disney Studios made three park films. In 2003, there was of course Pirates of the Caribbean, which was a massive hit and franchise that made the whole operation worthwhile. The other two films were not nearly as successful. The Haunted Mansion made $75 million in the States on a budget of $90 million, but did better overseas. The first park film was The Country Bears, based on the Country Bear Jamboree. That ride holds the distinction of being the last project Uncle Walt ever worked on. According to the New York Times, Walt developed the review for the Mineral Kings Ski Resort and planned for a spot near Sequoia National Park in California. Mark Davis, an animator who created Cruella de Vil from 101 Dalmatians, designed the characters. The Times also noted that even by the late 1980s, the lines at the ride were dwindling, and guests were able to walk right on even during the most crowded days at the parks. What better way to fill up queues than a nationwide theatrical release? The Country Bears hits the well-beaten path of Disney emotional beats and storytelling, but the man who directed it made a career of lambasting these tropes at Warner Brothers Television Animation. Director Peter Hastings was part of the team that brought about a Warner Brothers animation renaissance, with hits like Animaniacs and Pinky and the Brain, shows that actively criticized anything that was self-righteous, serious, or overly emotional. These shows were to Disney what the Antichrist is to Christ. Based on his success on the writing staff of these shows, he was given the opportunity to reinvigorate ABC's Saturday mornings. He did so by being the creative force behind the One Saturday Morning interstitials, with crazy bits like Manny the Uncanny, an insane former cruise ship performer who now does Man on the Street segments, expertly played by Peter's Warner Brothers writing buddy, Paul Rugg. There was also Mrs. Munger's Class, which was crudely talking yearbook photos, and The Monkey Boys, silent Keystone Cops like slapstick. Disney finally had a little bit of Looney Tunes injected into its veins. One Saturday Morning quickly became the most popular kids' block, and it was Peter's overwhelming success here that had him climbing the corporate ladder at the House of Mouse.
I did a lot of different work at Disney. I worked with Imagineering, I worked with the online, and you know, kind of in a consultant capacity, and then I started to work with features. You know, I was there reading stuff and just helping them kind of develop things and stuff like that, and then I just said, like, you know what, I just realized it's like, I want to be a director. It's like all of this stuff that I'm doing is very much like directing. And then Brigham Taylor like handed me the script to Country Bears, which I think probably 2 weeks before that I was like, I cannot believe Disney's making the Country Bears. And then like 2 weeks later I was directing it. And then, you know, as somebody told me, the director told me, you know, I said, do you think I should do this? And she said, if you get an opportunity to direct a studio movie, you should take it. And so I did, even though I had some questions about the material. And it had a very mixed experience. In terms of work, it was a blast. I enjoyed it so much, but, you know, it just wasn't a great project. I mean, it happened because they were like, we want to go dig into our IP at the park and develop movies. And so there were three movies that they made, which was The Country Bears and The Haunted Mansion with Eddie Murphy, and then the successful one, which is The Pirates of the Caribbean. We went first, and there was a script, and was a very kind of modest budgeted sort of thing. I don't know. Nobody really knew exactly how it was going to turn out.
The script was penned by Mark Perez, who recently wrote the hit Game Night in 2018. Perez was working in a bank while trying to make it as a screenwriter. He wrote a comedic script called Find Stevie, in which a 30-year-old man living with his parents runs away from home, and his parents search for him the way they would a child, with the aid of milk cartons. The script got Disney's attention, and they hired him for $150,000. Within a year, he had written The Country Bears, and Paul Rugg was brought in to punch it up.
I think the first time I had heard about it was when Brigham Taylor wanted me to pitch him an idea for the movie. So I was brought in at that point. I think before Mark Perez did his pitch, I was supposed to do mine. That attraction was one of my favorite attractions as a kid. And I thought it was weird to begin with that they were making a movie about country bears. The same way I thought it was weird they were making a movie about, you know, the Haunted Mansion. And then I was like, what are they going to do with Pirates of the Caribbean? That's going to be stupid. Well, I was wrong. So there you go. So, yeah. You know, it just seemed, I'll just be totally honest, it seemed like, really? They're going to make a movie about these attractions? It just seemed so, I don't know, it seemed so corporate to me. And my mom was dying of cancer at the time, so I really never devoted myself entirely to it. I was sort of flying up to be with her. But my take on it was, I think, dramatically different than the direction they originally went. Where they sort of reveled in the fact that there were bears, you know, sort of living among humans, and that always messed with my head. I could never figure that out. I was like, really? Okay. But that's just me, because I'm sort of very practical when it comes to that stuff. So I think my idea was that there was this place in Tennessee where these talking bears entertained and only for other bears, and they were talking bears. And then I think my idea was that someone discovers them and trouble ensues. So more like the ride, like there's this secret place where you go where you want to see the bears perform. That was my sort of take, and they didn't like it. They decided to go more with the Blues Brothers sort of idea. So then Peter said, hey, I'm directing a movie. I'm like, no way. And he said, yeah, it's Country Bears. I go, no way. Well, was I surprised? No, because it seemed like that was the next step for Peter. So not surprised, but like, it's like, ooh, I have a friend who's a director. Cool. He just dove right into it, which was kind of cool to visit him in his big new office on the Disney lot. And I'm like, oh, awesome. Cool. And he said, would I take a stab at doing a punch-up on the script? And so I think over a couple, maybe it was a month or 2 months, I would just go scene by scene and add more comedic bits to it, like the little things, like the bear. I forget who's the big, huge bear that loves grass. Big Al. He sort of became my favorite character. He spoke so slow, and he said such sweet, stupid things that it really made me laugh. When he wants to talk proudly about fescue or Bermuda rye or the grass that he's growing, that was really fun to write. I think my favorite line in the whole movie, which is weird, is when he's talking to them about the grass, then the two cops leave, and then Big Al looks down at the grass and he says, they like you. That made me laugh. That was just really kind of weird, and that he's telling the grass that they should be proud. I don't know. It's weird stuff like that. And I think we, was it giving Rhodey a chicken? I think so. Yeah, we gave him a chicken. You know, it was just little things within the scene to make them funnier. I think we sort of wrote their origin story sort of like in the style of biography. you know, how they came to be, who they came to be, invented sort of a whole history to that. That was a ton of fun. And then it was excised, as I recall, or changed or made shorter. So Peter would sort of distill for me what the general consensus was on each scene, what was lacking, what they needed more of. I think a lot of it was emotional core stuff, like what does Barry want? And these were fast turnarounds, by the way. And I don't know if Peter's told you, but I am the slowest writer in the world. I'll sort of think about it all day. I'll vacuum, I'll clean the jacuzzi, I'll give the dog a brush, I'll build a model. I sort of ponder, and I thought we were going to do that, like when Peter gave me the first scene, and Peter called me and goes, no, this isn't like that. He goes, we need it tomorrow. So he was like, really, this is fast. I was like, oh, wow, I don't think I like that. Warner Brothers, you sort of know what it is, which is, we are here to have fun, make fun of stuff, make fun of heart, make fun of people that like heart, basically make fun of Disney. And then with Country Bears, I think, but Peter certainly realized that, you know, when you realize you make a movie like that, I think that you need, especially with Little Barry, towards the end, and he's trying to find community, family, like why it was so important to him, the whole family concept. I think Peter and I came up with the idea that those people that are your friends, your family, I forget what the quote was. See, that shows you what a dramatic impact it had on me, but it took us a long time to sort of get to that. I don't think we necessarily said, here we go with another after-school special. It felt a little bit better than that.
I mean, I think I definitely went through sort of a creative journey of sort of accepting that, you know, outside of a sketch comedy kind of situation, that it's emotion that pulls any story along and is what makes people interested, or just generally things that they feel are the most important. So that can be suspense, and that can be, you know, heart, and that can be joy, and that can be fear and all that kind of stuff. But it's really, you know, an emotional thing that will carry a longer story. So, I mean, it just kind of came naturally to that property. It's funny because it's kind of the Blues Brothers. And then that Muppet movie came out not too long ago. It's almost exactly the same story about we need to save this building and we got to get the band back together. And they go traveling around looking for everybody. It's classic.
One of the problems that Peter encountered was his characters in the Warner Brothers universe were infinitely malleable, and now he was dealing with puppets, with limited mobility, limited facial expressions, and limited physical comedy capabilities.
The Bears, they couldn't do a lot of the comedy that was kind of in it. The script started out with like a behind the music about the Country Bears, and we made a whole like long fake behind the music about their career and all that sort of stuff. There was really kind of our sense of humor was in a lot of that stuff, but there was just so much stuff that didn't work. You know, it's sort of like, hey, we wrote this really funny script, and it's like, oh, who is going to be in it? And it's like, oh, we got like Russell Crowe and somebody to be hilarious. You know, it's like, that's not going to work. And you just didn't get the performance, and so it kind of pulled itself into, you know, another direction. Technically, they're like very complicated. You know, we had like, you know, all these puppeteers. Like every bear is basically two people. You have the puppeteer, you have the guy who's in the suit, and then you have me, and like I had to wear a headset all the time so I could talk to them. These mechanical bears, and there's like dudes in the bear suits, and they can't see, you know, and they're like, they're literally like blind, and you're like, oh, you need to go pick up a glass, and they'd have to practice it for a half an hour. You know, it's just technically complex just to do it at all. So then you don't necessarily have the luxury of getting to the next level of subtleties of timing and things like that. It was like making a movie with sailboats. You know, it's like, everybody come back to one. And it's like, all right, we'll be there in 45 minutes. And wait, come back. A lot of that. And just don't go in the sun. We don't look good. Just sort of realizing that they couldn't do it is like, you know, sort of after you've shot it, you go like, oh, that's not really as funny as it should be. The bears were all built by the Henson Creature Shop. I had the distinction of Lisa Henson telling me that, Peter, you probably have the distinction of making the last animatronic movie ever. The week before it was done, they say, like, you know what, if you guys do any more of these, you should probably do them CG. You know what, it was like also it was my first movie, and there's so many things that you have to think about and concentrate about that you can't always think on a higher level. So like now, if I do a TV animation series, I've done so many of them that it's like I don't have to worry about any of the workings of it, about how it gets done or any of that kind of stuff. I can really think about how it's going to feel and how it's going to play.
Peter doesn't stress, or not that I've ever seen. In fact, I think the more pressure cooker the situation is, the more relaxed Peter looks. Now, that's not to say inside he's not a seething ball of, you know, nerves. You know, Peter comported himself incredibly smoothly on a set. He really did. I'm trying to think, well, what if that was me? You know, I would have been running around and, you know, probably drinking milk and, you know, hiding in my trailer with a thumb in my mouth. So he did it great. He really did it great.
Unfortunately for Peter, there was also a forced musical number, which seems tailor-made for Disney Channel interstitials, and the film comes to a grinding halt. Disney had done well launching Christina Aguilera with Mulan, and now was trying to find Miley Cyrus, before they knew what a Miley Cyrus was.
Like the one in the diner, I think I showed up one day when Peter was shooting that, and I thought that was terrific in the diner, and it just really worked well, and it was really fun. But the one video piece that, for me, was just sort of sandwiched in there because everybody thought she was going to be a big star was that, and I forget even what her name was. She sort of goes from one background to another, and I was like, well, first of all, who is that? And it just seemed so synergistic that this has got nothing to do with anything. And I still don't know who that was. That means absolutely nothing, because I don't know who most people are, but I certainly didn't know who that was. By the way, who was that? And it sort of cracks me up because it just looks like they told Peter, look, we're going to use Betsy Schneer. She's incredibly talented. She's one of our new people. And so it had that feeling to me. And anyway, yeah.
Christopher Walken was making stranger films around this time in his career, and Walken had always made slightly off-kilter choices. For his role in The Deer Hunter, he only ate bananas, so his character would appear ghostly white. But in the 2000s, he was making different artistic choices. He played a sociopath janitor in Joe Dirt, then in Fatboy Slim's Weapon of Choice, a dancing businessman. And in 2002, he played Benny Boggswiggle, the vengeful armpit farter who lost to the Country Bears in a high school talent show. Then again, when it comes to Walken, maybe none of these are out of character.
He was right at home working with a bunch of animatronic bears. He worked on the movie for 2 weeks, and it was kind of a blast and a trip and an experience. And, you know, one of the first times I got in a car with him, and he was like, I gotta tell you, this is one of the best scripts I've ever read. And I was like, what are you talking about? How about The Deer Hunter, dude? And no, really. And then we're like in this trailer, and we go like, so what do you think I'm like, I do like a Southern guy? And I go like, I don't know, what would that sound like? And I'm like, oh my God, I just want you to do Christopher Walken. He goes like, sound like this. Hey, what are you doing? Hey. Like some weird Brando impression or something. And I just kind of stared at him, and he goes like, I could just do me. And I go like, yeah, let's do that. Yeah, he was a lot of fun, anyway.
Walken was nominated for a Razzie, but lost to Hayden Christensen's portrayal of Anakin Skywalker. It's an unfair slight on Walken, who hams it up and completely understands what he's supposed to do for the film. And he's one of the highlights. And why did Walken love the script so much?
That he got $500,000 for 2 weeks of work, for 10 days of work. Eisner, when he first saw the first test, he said, it's it. And then, you know, what happened was the first screenings that we did, test screenings, were like right after 9/11. And so people were in a very, very specific mood. And they're like, we love this movie. It's so great. We need this kind of wholesome, you know, it's family, love, entertainment, kind of, you know, totally non-threatening, you know, sort of thing. They were excited about it, you know, not by the time it came out.
I went to the first one in, I want to say it was La Cañada. And I remember I watched it, and that's when it had their backstory at the beginning. And I remember that I thought it went really well. You know, but that's just me. I'm like, hey, this is fun. Look, everyone, they made a movie. Wow, this is kind of fun.
and people were laughing in all the right places. And then there was a, I want to say one of the people from Disney, a very high up person, I don't remember her name. After the screening, I overheard her say something like, well, we have issues and we got to fix stuff. And I was like, wow, okay. So I remember that one. And I remember everyone not necessarily being happy. And I was kind of confused why. But that's just me.
And also they put it out in the summer. So it came out at the same time as Austin Powers, same day. And like, you know, Spy Kids was out and there was another thing. It was, the competition was ridiculous. It's more of a February movie, maybe. You learn things about the movie business, too, and it's like the movie didn't open, which has nothing to do with if the movie is good or bad or anything. It's just like people, you know, they just like look at the poster and go like, nah, you know, it's like that simple. It's really true. It's like, what is that one simple thing that makes somebody go like, oh, yeah, oh, it's a Scorsese movie, oh, okay. Or it's like, oh, Ryan Gosling's in it, oh, okay. Or it's like, oh, that poster looks freaking cool, you know, whatever. Turns out that, like, you know, a poster with a bunch of big smiling hillbilly bears didn't really click in America. Yeah, the whole thing was just like a super tough sell. I mean, just that kind of thing, too, of like, you know, we're like, we want to change the name because we don't think the Country Bears is very attractive. And they're like, that's crazy. You're blowing off the Disney history. You've got it. There's people who love this franchise and blah, 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 and all that sort of stuff. And then literally like a week before, you know, the marketing guy tells me, he goes like, you probably should have called it something else. You know, it's like the same dude who said, don't change the name. Well, I was supposed to re-energize the ride, which they dismantled while we were shooting the film and replaced it with, like, Winnie the Pooh's honeypot, you know, something.
The ride would close in California in 2001. However, the Florida ride would remain open. But half the synergistic effort was gone.
The number one thing that's important when you make a movie is that it makes money. And then the second thing is it any good? So it didn't make money, so that nobody even cares about the second one. And I'm not even saying it was good. But so it's very difficult to just get another gig like that. Studio has a movie, and they have a movie they want to make, and they're looking for a director, right? So it's something that doesn't already have a director attached. Every major agency will send them a list of like 25 people that they think are good fit for the movie, who want to do the movie, and who have made multiple movies that have already made money. So it's super, super competitive. So if you made a movie about animatronic bears that didn't make any money, it's like, yeah, I don't think so. Not that guy.
I say all that going, well, that was a terrible idea. But of all the things sort of I've been associated with, like my daughter just graduated high school and I helped direct the play, and so many of the kids will come up and go, you know, they won't talk about Freakazoid, they won't talk about Animaniacs, but they'll go, you did something for Country, that was like my favorite movie as a kid. And I was like, wow, really? Okay. So, and I know it didn't get great reviews when it came out and whatever, but I've met more people that loved that movie. They really did love it.
You know, that was like over 15 years ago. And the other night, somebody came up to me and said, like, oh, my God, I loved the Country Bears when I was a kid. And I got here. I think you're maybe the first person who told me that.
Peter Hastings went on to executive produce Kung Fu Panda, Legends of Awesomeness, 2012's Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles TV reboot, and most recently, the epic tales of Captain Underpants for Netflix. With all his success, is there anything he would have done differently on the Country Bears?
I've asked myself that question. It's very hard to say because I think there's some things that I would have done differently in terms of real simple things like how it was shot, but I think probably would have needed to play more sincerely young as opposed to it was trying to be a little cooler and couldn't get there. And then there's the other thing, which would you have done differently, which is not do it.